Good morning, all my fellow federal phoenixes flying through the fire of the federal justice court system. So today's video I'm going to do on federal target letters. Yes, I know there's a fly buzzing around my house, and even though it's making me crazy, I'm going to try to ignore it for a few minutes to do the video. So when I got my federal target letter, the incident that has led to all the criminal charges in my life was a couple years, almost 2 years ago. And I was arrested, and, you know, the state charged me, and I was on bond for a year and a half with the state, and the state dropped their charges. Well, and of course I thought, thank God, you know, this is all over with. Maybe a month or so later, I got my federal target letter. Now, your target letter could, a lot of people, it just comes in the mail. If you get a federal target letter, it may be served to you by a U.S. Marshal or by your local process server or sheriff's department. In my case, my federal target letter was actually served to me personally by the arresting officer from the incident 2 years ago, who's a local cop. Apparently, he really wanted to be the one to hand me the target letter himself for whatever reason. But so anyway, when you get this target letter, it's going to come in an envelope, obviously addressed to you, and the return address will be like United States of America, it's early, federal court, in my case, you know, Southern District of West Virginia, you know, whatever. Your target letter is going to say something, if you get one, along the lines of, in the matter regarding the United States of America versus you. In my case, you know, my name is Audrey Thompson, so United States of America versus Audrey Thompson. The letter will go on to say something to the effect of, you know, we're sending you this letter to inform you that you are the target of a federal investigation. There will be a grand jury hearing, and usually this hearing is about a week out from when you get the target letter. I think mine was going to be in April or something, but we'll say April 23rd. At which time, the federal prosecutor, and sometimes it'll mention who he is, you know, as the, you know, intends to seek an indictment against you with a grand jury, and for charges related to the incident that took place at your residence on this date. For some of you, the target letter will say, you know, we, you know, intend to seek an indictment against you per, you know, via grand jury for the incident that occurred, you know, or for the events related to, you know, your employment at, you know, TrumpCharities.com or whatever. So anywho, and it goes on to say in this letter, they invite you. They invite you to your own hanging. Isn't that cute? That's hilarious. Very tongue-in-cheek. But they exploit the uneducated and just the general fear of folks. Of the criminal system by saying, you are welcome to come to the grand jury hearing where we're going to indict you. Now, you can't bring witnesses. You can't have a lawyer. You know, you're not, no lawyer can even be in the room. But you can come if you'd like, and we will interrogate you. Do not accept their invitation. Don't do it. I would imagine the only people that have ever in history accepted an invitation to their own funeral via, you know, federal grand jury were people who were, you know, like most people. I mean, everyone gets a little shook up by this. You know, you're scared. You're thinking, well, if I just, you know, if I'm voluntarily doing what they're asking me to do, then they'll go easier on me or life will be easier. But this is a trick. Do not go to the grand jury hearing to give testimony against yourself. I mean, literally, they're asking you to be the star witness to put you in prison. And they don't give a crap about, you know, oh, I'm going to get up there and I'm going to say, yeah, I did this, you know, I laundered this money, but this is why, but I'm a good person. The prosecutor's going to cut you off before you even start saying that crap. He don't care. He don't want the jury, the grand jury to hear it, and they're not going to hear it. You know, and then they have what they call the perjury trap. If you're foolish enough to go up there and volunteer to go to your own grand jury hearing and give testimony against yourself, they will grill you. They will, the prosecutor will ask you 100 questions a million different ways, rapid fire. And he will do this until some way, somehow, something can be construed as you perjuring yourself. And at that point, he will stop because he's you know, completed his little trick. And he'll say, oh, he, she just perjured themselves. They just said ABC, but 2 hours ago when asked, you know, this and that, they said something else. And now not only are you going, you're going to get indicted if the feds want to indict you. I mean, there's a saying in the federal justice system, you know, grand jury will indict a hamburger. If they want to indict you, they're indicting you. I mean, there's no question about that. So you going will not prevent that. It will not lessen the charges that will be, you know, put against you. Matter of fact, it will likely increase the charges against you if you go volunteer to give testimony against yourself at your grand jury hearing. And in addition to that, they'll probably be able to tack on a perjury charge somewhere because they will beat you down until you stumble upon your words. So it is a trap. You do not go to your own funeral. I mean, that you just don't. You do not give testimony at your own grand jury hearing. This is a grand jury hearing against you. You're the target, or you're one of the targets. In my case, my letter said one of the targets, never specified who the other targets were. I don't even care to know at this point. You know what I mean? It's not my business. But, so, what you want to do when you get your target letter, the very first, that day, within an hour of getting your target letter, if you can afford a federal lawyer, lawyer up right now. If you cannot afford one, you need to get a hold of your local federal courthouse, talk to the clerk, and tell her you need an application for a federal public defender, because now that you've been informed you're the target of investigation, you qualify for representation. See, if you get indicted or arrested by the feds, or the feds pick up a state charge, at that point, you know, you'll be informed of your right to have a federal public defender, and the paperwork will be presented to you and all that. Target letters are almost a very backdoor kind of thing, and that they will repeatedly tell you that you're not going to be able, whether you can afford it or not, to have any representation or even any witnesses at the grand jury hearing. But what they don't tell you in that is if you cannot afford a lawyer, you need to get one right now. They would much rather you sit at home and just wait to get indicted, wait for the marshals to come kick in your door, seize your crap, lock you up, wait till you go to that initial, you know, hearing in front of a federal judge, and then go, oh, we'll get you a lawyer. See, now this is really to your detriment. The reason why you want to lawyer up as soon as you get your target letter, the big reason, which I've learned this by experience, is because if once you have a lawyer, because that the federal prosecutor is not going to talk to you. He didn't give a crap to talk to you. But he will talk to a lawyer. So once you have a lawyer, even a public defender, and if you have a target letter, they will move this process along very quickly in assigning you your public defender. And the prosecutor will know that you have this public defender pretty quick. And once the prosecutor knows this, there's a very good chance that the prosecutor will reach out to your public defender and say, look, you know, on this particular grand jury session, I have, you know, I'm seeking indictments against 30 different people. It's going to be a long day. If I could just scratch your client's name off the list, you know, if you can, you know, give me, you know, confirmation, a commitment from you and your client that you will in fact be taking a plea deal and not be taking this to trial, you know, I won't bother to indict. And then we can do a pre-indictment plea offer. That's what you want to happen. Matter of fact, if you get a public defender or lawyer, as soon as you know who they are, tell them I need you to contact the prosecutor today to see about a pre-indictment plea offer. More often than not, because you're saving the court's time, you're saving the prosecutor time, they don't mind doing a pre-indictment plea offer. The thing about federal prison that really hurts a lot of people is mandatory minimums and the guidelines. And yes, your judge can do an upward departure or downward departure, meaning giving you a little more or a little less time than what the guidelines suggest. But they have to actually write up a report after they sentence you explaining, regardless of how they sentence you, explaining why they sentenced you the way that they did and why it was, you know, reasonable and adequate. And so they tend to stay near the guidelines. You know, some judges like to go a little over, some like to go a little under, but generally the guidelines. And for a lot of people, those guidelines are pretty damning. You know, you could be a person with no priors, but because a lot of money or a lot of drugs or a lot of guns were involved in your case, you know, your guidelines may be you got to do a minimum of 20 years, 15 years. Whereas if you get a target letter, which most people in the federal justice system did not get target letters, you know, but if you happen to be one of the fortunate few who get a target letter, you need to really handle that well. And not just take it for granted. Because, you know, your pre-indictment plea offer may be, you're looking at 20 years by the guidelines, maybe 10 years, or 7 to 10, 8 to 10 range. And you want to hurry up and sign that plea deal. And when you sign your plea deal, after you get your target letter and you get your, if you get a pre-indictment plea offer as a result of this, your plea deal is probably going to say things you don't agree with. It's probably going to exaggerate your involvement. It's probably going to exaggerate quantities of money or drugs or guns or number of trips you made trafficking people, you know, from a port to a human trafficking warehouse. I don't know. I don't know what you're into, but I'm just saying it's going to, there are probably going to be some statements in there that you find to be rather exaggerated. You do have the option at that point of trying to have your lawyer negotiate with the prosecutor to change those statements or you know, make them less kind of crazy and left field. But then again, you know, most lawyers will tell you, you know, don't muddy the waters. I mean, the important thing is, in your pre-indictment plea offer, is this is what your guideline point range was. This is how much time you were looking at if indicted, and the maximum of your plea offer is X number of months or years. And there's going to be a huge difference between these two numbers. So do you really want to risk the prosecutor taking his offer off the table or making the offer for more time because now he has to go back and do more paperwork, or he has to argue back and forth with your lawyer about what to change in the paperwork? Or do you just want to shut up and go with the program? And you know if you shut up and go with the program, your outcome is going to be the plea deal. What you do or do not do is between you and your lawyer. I can't give you legal advice. I'm not your lawyer. But on a very personal level, as a stranger on the internet, take it for what it's worth. I say if your plea offer is offering you less than half of the mandatory minimum had you been indicted, take the plea offer, shut your mouth, and then at that point you need to just focus on what you can do to get the best possible outcome at sentencing, which I have videos about that too, preparing for your sentencing, preparing for prison, all that kind of thing. Because there's a lot of things you can do proactively after you've taken your plea deal, or even just once you've signed your plea deal and you haven't even had your plea hearing yet, but you know ultimately you're going to go in front of a judge for sentencing. There are a lot of things you can proactively do, you, without any legal training or anything, to really lessen the chances of you getting a harsher outcome and to maximize the chances of you getting a better outcome. There are things you can do to help yourself. And of course, some of these things are, you know, don't just go round up 100 character reference letters from everyone you know. You need to understand the purpose of a character reference letter, what it does, what it needs to say, what it should not say, what it should not discuss your criminal activity or the person's opinion of you on a criminal level. You know, I make videos about all these things. I mean, watch my video, seriously. If you've got a target letter, do what I'm telling you to do in this video, but then go through and watch all my videos, and you will see not only my journey through the federal justice system, but you will see step by step what you can do to help yourself in this situation. And because your lawyer is only going to do but so much, even if you're paying him, don't expect miracles. So you'll probably get a pre-indictment plea offer if you get a target letter and you lawyer up quick enough. Now, if you don't lawyer up, they're going to follow through with their threat. They're going to indict you. Now, how that plays out for you, whether the marshals just arrest you while you're in Walmart with your kids shopping for school clothes, or whether they kick in your door at 3 a.m., maybe cause you to lose your home. You know, it's really their dance. You know, it's their choice if they want to do a nice slow dance with you, or if they want a tango. But they're going to come. They're going to come for you. It's not going to be pretty. It's probably going to be very public. And you can avoid all of that by just lawyering up when you get your target letter. Sadly, like I said, most people don't get target letters. I think really they kind of send out target letters for one of three reasons. One, and probably most common, I think is true in my case, is just because they know that certain defendants will have enough sense to just make everybody's life easier, including their own, and be willing to take a pre-indictment plea offer and save the courts, especially the prosecutor, a good bit of time and resources. If they just say, hey, look, we're going to get you. We're going to lock you up. You know, do you want to take it on the chin, or do you want to put up a fight? You know, personally, I'm just going to take it on the chin because I know you're not going to beat the Fed. You may think that, oh, I have money. I have powerful friends. I'm well-liked. Let me give you a list of some folks who didn't beat the feds. Martha Stewart, Lori Loughlin, El Chapo. I don't think you got more money than El Chapo.
I don't think you're a more common, well-loved household name than Martha Stewart. And I doubt you have more powerful friends than Lori Loughlin. So don't set yourself up for failure and disappointment by even trying to pull the I got money, I got friends, you know, I know people. People like me card is going to do you minimal favors in this situation, seriously. So you lawyer up, you get your pre-indictment plea offer. And at that point, that's really all you need to do with your target letter. You'll get your plea hearing set. I made a video about how to prepare for your plea hearing. I made a video of me going into my plea hearing. When I came out of my plea hearing, the things that I was surprised by, the things I knew to expect, you know, all the way down to how you should dress. Because all these little tiny things, you know, it's a million tiny pieces. There are a million tiny pieces to putting together the best possible outcome for you. And some of these things may seem kind of mundane or insignificant, but when you add them up in their entirety, you know, a drop of water is a very insignificant thing. But we've seen time and time again all over the world where just a steady drop of water, drip, 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 has formed canyons and caves and mountains. So you want to be consistent. You want to be proactive. Throughout this process, whether you get a target letter or not. This is specifically for those with target letters. But, oh, the three types of people I think that get target letters or that it appears to me from my research and my experience to get target letters are people like myself who just know that even if you were to get these charges thrown out, that means they're just going to come back harder with bigger and badder and scarier charges. So you might as well just let them get the win they want and be done with it. They're the feds. Who's the feds? It's not just the DA. The feds are the CIA, the FBI, you know, Homeland Security, ATF, DEA. These are the feds. And these people have a bottomless budget and endless resources to convince 12 people that you've committed a crime and you should go to prison. That's not hard to do. I mean, seriously, we could get the Pope out here, Mother Teresa. We could resurrect Mother Teresa. And I guarantee you the feds could stack 24 charges against her by the end of the week and parade professional witnesses, you know, that they're paying for. And now the court for months to validate or erase any doubt that she is a hardened criminal. So if you think that you somehow are you know, smarter or have more resources or they can't do it to you, you're wrong. You're just wrong. And, you know, and now's the time to just accept that and so you can move the heck forward because you really don't have time to sulk and feel sorry for yourself at this point. You don't. You don't have that luxury. But the second type of people that tend to get target letters are people who they intend to indict if they have to, but they really don't want to indict, but they really don't even want you to go to prison. Maybe they think you have some information that's useful and they know that you're not going to willingly give it up. So they want to compel you. So they're telling you, you can come to your own grand jury hearing and help us indict you, or we'll indict you later, or you get a lawyer and get a pre-indictment plea offer. But either way, for this second type of person, how this is going to play out, and from what I understand, this is a minimal amount of people, is ultimately they're going to either continue to threaten to level charges against you or they will bring charges against you. But those charges go away like a bad dream when you cooperate and give them what they want, information-wise. And if you don't, of course, well, then you pay the price and you go to prison for not, you know, being a voluntary employee of the government helping to incarcerate other people. So the first type is those who, you know, really they just kind of randomly selected to just minimize paperwork and use of resources for the DA and the federal prosecutor's office. That would probably be me, I would say. The second type is a target letter against someone in the hopes of using the threat of charges or the fact that they're about to get charges against them to compel them to give up information. And if they don't cooperate, you go to prison. I mean, prison. That's generally, if you get a target letter, you're going to go to prison. Unless you're in that second group, then my understanding is, and it could be a written legend, but I've heard of it, then in that second group of people, once they give up whatever, you know, I don't know if they go into witness protection or their charges just get dropped. I really don't know, you know, the, you know what I've seen in movies and just jailhouse rumors. Other people have told me, oh, this guy had this situation or that situation. But I know that the charges have disappeared for some folks. Now, the third type of people who get a target letter, and this is going to be your higher-end white-collar criminals, are the people who, see, once you get a target letter, it is the feds telling you, not only are we watching you, you're the target of an active criminal investigation. Oh, and by the way, here in about a week, we're going to get an indictment against you, and we're going to, you know, kick your feet out from under you. And what a lot of white-collar criminals will do under that circumstance is they will panic. I mean, I think everyone has a little bit of panic when they get a target letter regardless. But they will panic to the extreme of, more often than not, and mind you, if you're getting this target letter, you know that you're under a shit ton of surveillance right now. Because this target letter could very well be what it is for the third group of folks, a different type of trap. See, the average person, you know, maybe you've been getting away with smuggling some AK-47s in on your cousin's yacht for years, and Now the feds are saying, you know, we're going to indict you and you're going to go to prison. Generally, what a person will do at that point, particularly white-collar criminals, you know, financial crimes, things of that nature, and I imagine some blue-collar, is the first thing they're going to do is they're going to want to destroy evidence. Destroying evidence is a crime. They're going to want to witness tamper, which is a crime. They're going to want to talk to their business associates, maybe some friends and family. Hey, if anyone asks, I was with you last Thursday. Hey, just remember, man, that favor I did for you, it never happened, you know. But they're going to want to witness tamper and destroy evidence. And they're probably even, in some cases, going to want to fabricate evidence, try to create false proof of their innocence or where they were or their own involvement or whatever. And so for this third group, what happens is they don't give a crap if you lawyer up or not. You know, that wasn't the point of you getting one. You know, you weren't given a target letter to save anybody any time. You were given a target letter to speed up closing an investigation against you. You weren't given a target letter because they necessarily want info from you. You were given a target letter to finalize the investigation against you. And how they're going to finalize it, most likely, is by adding witness tampering and destroying evidence, interfering in a federal investigation, obstruction of justice. I mean, we could go on with a dozen different charges that are likely going to pop up in your life, in addition to what they were already had you on, or already were going to allege against you, because you panicked. You pressed the panic button when you got the target letter, you know. So when you get your target letter, regardless of your circumstances, whether you're guilty of something or not, whether you're white or blue-collar criminal, don't panic. Breathe through this. But you need to move quickly and calculate. You need to be like Denzel Washington in The Equalizer, you know. You have to be someone who is calm, who's thinking straight, and is being proactive, but is not being erratic and impulsive. Lawyer up immediately. Lawyer up, lawyer up, lawyer up. If you cannot afford a lawyer, contact the prosecutor, the federal clerk, and they will give you the paperwork to lawyer up. As soon as you get a lawyer, call them immediately and say, listen, I need to get, I'm trying to get a federal pre-indictment plea offer. I'm trying to save the DA some, the prosecutor some time and resources. I need you to talk to him about this ASAP, you know. And generally, you know, if someone tells the prosecutor, you know, hey, you can drag this person through the mud and give them 10 years, you know, and spend, you know, a few hundred thousand dollars, or, you know, in a few, you know, weeks or months of your time, or, you know, they can do half as much time, you spend next to nothing, maybe a couple thousand dollars of resources, which looks good for the prosecutor professionally, that he's, you know, minimizing resource waste, and we can just put this thing to bed. Trust and believe, there are enough people at any given time facing federal charges, under federal investigation, on federal watch list, that, you know, doubling your time is really an insignificant move in everyone's eyes. They just want to convict you. They want the conviction, and more often than not, they want you to go to prison for some period of time. So when you accept that you're going to be convicted and you're going to prison, now you're in a position to emotionally, you know, process things. But also to, now you're kind of reclaiming your power in the situation. You're saying, okay, I know I'm going to go to prison. I know I'm going to be a convicted felon. So I'm going to do this under my terms, you know. And I'm going to make this as expeditious and easy for myself as possible. And in the process, I'm going to, you know, I make a lot of videos about how to prepare for prison financially, spiritually, socially, economically, how to survive prison, you know, financially, socially, you know, so on and so forth. And you need to really just take this time to educate yourself and prepare yourself. Accept it for what it is. It'd probably be a good idea to kind of figure out which one of those three groups of people who get target letters you fall into. And that may actually help you kind of plan on how you're going to proceed as well. But once you get that target letter, know that you're most likely going to be convicted of a federal felony. You're most likely going to prison. And you need to immediately and proactively prepare your life for that next phase. But I made this video also because when I got my federal target letter, I had never heard of federal target letters. I had contacted some loved ones in federal prisons, some loved ones in federal halfway houses, and said, hey, man, what's a target letter? What does this mean? And nobody had answers for me. I went on Google, and the answers I got were very vague and confusing and conflicting. So I made this video so in the event that you're just now starting your federal journey and you got a target letter, you can actually tell, you know, you'll know up from down on what's going on and how to proceed. So I hope this video has helped you. Sorry I didn't have notes. I was probably a little less organized than usual today. But I hope this video has been of some assistance, whether you've got it in target letter, whether you're just curious about the federal criminal justice system, you know, whatever reason you have. Maybe you just find this thing kind of thing interesting, or maybe you're getting a degree in this and you just want to do some research. But if you like the video, feel free to subscribe if you want to see future upcoming videos. And then also hit the dingy button if you want notifications. I will be going to federal prison in a few months. And when I do, these videos will no longer be being made. They'll just be whatever's currently on YouTube. And then when I come out of prison, I'll start making new videos. So if you hit the notification thingy, then after I kind of disappear from the internet for a few years, when I pop back up with all this new information and experience, you will be notified immediately. So anywho, so that's it. I know this has drug out quite a bit. So good day. God bless. I just wanted to be thorough. So I wish you all a wonderful day. And to my fellow federal phoenixes flying through the fire of the federal criminal justice system, buckle up, baby. It's going to be a rough ride for us. But we're in this together, and we're going to get through it because we have to.